You're watching Musical Theater MASH.
Musicals are never done. You publish your book and it's done. You screen your movie and it's done. Well, unless you're George Lucas. But every time a musical is performed, every night, every company, every theater, the musical flexes into its new shape. So it's no surprise that with such a malleable art form, sometimes entire songs are rewritten or dropped entirely. So, here are 10 songs cut from musicals that you might not have known about. Mama's Talkin' Soft, cut from Gypsy.
Mama's talkin' soft, Mama's got a plan.
Cutting a song can be difficult when portions of the song are reprised later in the show, but that's exactly what happened with Mama's Talkin' Soft from Gypsy. If the title sounds familiar, it's because you've probably heard the lyric Mama's Talkin' Loud during the finale song, Rose's Turn. Now, all of Rose's Turn was intended to be made up of little snippets of earlier songs. Mama's Talkin' Soft was no exception. The song was intended to be sung by the young June and Louise on a very tall set piece. The actress playing Louise was afraid of heights, and the song was cut. Penny in My Pocket, cut from Hello, Dolly.
I put a penny in my pocket, and in a little time, that penny in my pocket had grown into a dime.
Here's a character development lesson. In Hello, Dolly, there are two things that we need to know about Horace Vandergelder at the beginning of the show. That he values money, and that he doesn't value women. Turns out, we need to spend more character exposition time on the women part and less on the money part. That's why the song Penny in My Pocket was cut from Hello, Dolly in out-of-town tryouts. A fine song, just not as important as It Takes a Woman, and therefore cut. The Jitterbug, cut from The Wizard of Oz.
It's a hoosus.
It's a hoosus?
It's a Watsis.
It's a Watsis?
Who's that?
Who's that?
Who's that?
Who's that? Who's that hiding in the treetops? It's that rascal, the Jitterbug.
The Wizard of Oz is a timeless classic. Timeless in no small part due to the late in-production removal of the song The Jitterbug. Originally, when Dorothy and friends were off to kill the witch, Miss Throp sends her swarm of insect jitterbugs to bite the adventurers and send them into a dancing frenzy. The song was really a leftover from an earlier draft of the script that was attempting to be more hip and appealing to a youthful 1930s audience. The Jitterbug was one of the only elements of that early draft to survive until the recording studio, and then it was cut and left on the floor of the editing room. I Could Be in Love with Someone Like You, cut from The Last 5 Years.
My first crush on an Irish girl, I was 10 years old, and her name was Elaine. Little redhead girl, well, she looked like you, but if you were 10, which you're clearly not. Not that you look old, but you get my... I'll just stop now.
Many musical theater writers pen semi-autobiographical pieces. You are supposed to write what you know, after all. And although the man himself would disagree with you, the rumor persists that Jason Robert Brown's The Last 5 Years is not so loosely based on his failed marriage with actress Teresa O'Neill. In fact, O'Neill found the similarities so striking that she filed a lawsuit against JRB, claiming that the show violated their divorce settlement. Brown had agreed that no future works would be about their marriage or divorce. Quietly, the song I Could Be in Love with Someone Like You was rewritten into Shiksa Goddess, and the matter was settled out of court. The Girl in 14G, cut from Thoroughly Modern Millie.
Just moved in to 14G, so cozy, calm, and peaceful. Heaven for a mouse like me, with quiet by the least.
What if you write a song to showcase a specific performer, and that person leaves the show? Well, that's exactly what happened with Kristen Chenoweth in the song The Girl in 14G during out-of-town tryouts for Thoroughly Modern Millie. Chenoweth had landed the title role, but pulled out of the project to pick up a TV show. Very likely, the canceled after 6 episodes NBC show Kristen. It's all cool, though, because we eventually ended up with the understudy's understudy, Sutton Foster, and, well, she's great. It's all in here, cut from a chorus line. Youngins on the internet with your YouTubes and your Spotifys may have never seen a cassette tape, but back in the 70s, that was the only way a composer and lyricist could record their first pre-production versions of musicals to pitch to prospective producers. These demo tapes, as you'd expect, often contained versions of songs that never even made it to opening night. With the 40th anniversary of A Chorus Line last year, though, Marvin Hamlisch and Edward Kleban's original recording of It's All In Here has started making the rounds. It's real easy to hear how this song morphed into I Hope I Get It, but also interesting to note how the focus shifted from the characters' resumes and headshots to the characters' wants and dreams. Good fortune, sir. Cut from Into the Woods.
Good fortune, good fortune, good fortune, sir. Hello and back, remember me. My name is Jack, and when you see what's in my sack, you'll more than be repaid. How right you were when you persuaded me to trade, though I'm afraid my mother, sir, when I displayed the beans to her, was quite dismayed. For with a shout, she threw them out and said I'd made without a doubt the dumbest trade she'd heard about, but no, sir, you were right.
When a musical goes through a big writing shift, the songs naturally go with it. That's what happened with Sondheim and Lapine when they shifted the characters' focuses in Into the Woods. Originally, Little Red, Cinderella, and Jack had the scenes and the songs that happened during their well-known stories' climaxes. But during rewrites, the focus shifted to what happens right after that event. We see Cinderella right after the ball, Little Red right after the wolf, and Jack right after the giant. One casualty of this was Good Fortune, Sir, the song that later became Giants in the Sky, where Jack recounts his adventure to the baker. Bonus fact, the voice you heard on that demo tape was Hedwig herself, a young John Cameron Mitchell. Can That Boy Foxtrot cut from Follies?
He hasn't much that's plus. You might describe him thus. A false alarm, a broken arm, an imitation Hitler ran with littler charm. But oh, can that boy Foxtrot?
Another Sondheim classic, Follies, is at its core a musical review. And while there's certainly a plot to tie everything together, you might wonder what would make a cut song less desirable than its replacement in a piece like that. Well, it was during out-of-town tryouts that old Steve-O decided, can that boy Foxtrot just wasn't working. It's a wonderfully innuendo-laden song with some classic Sondheim triple rhymes, and I'm sure it was difficult to watch it go. Thank God it did, though, because now we have the brilliantly electric I'm Still Here that replaced it. A little dental music, cut from Little Shop of Horrors.
A little dental music, strings are strumming, flutes are trilling, numbing minds and calming nerves while steps away. The beast is drilling, music in the lobby helps the patients to ignore the fact that writhing agony waits right behind the door.
Even if a song is great, if it's not sung by the main characters or about the main characters, then it often isn't important to the actual story, ripe material for cutting. This was the case with A Little Dental Music from Little Shop of Horrors. Intended to be sung by a patient as he nervously awaits his fate in the dentist's office, it didn't help the story, and the song never even made it to previews. A Step in the Right Direction, cut from Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
After all, it's a step in the right direction. It's a step in the right direction after all. After all, it's a step in the right direction. It's a step in the right direction after all.
And finally, sometimes a song is cut because it is just too stupid. The Disney live-action film Bedknobs and Broomsticks went through several cuts between its nearly 3-hour original theatrical release to its just barely 2-hour VHS release. But one song, A Step in the Right Direction, never even made it to the original Radio City Music Hall screening. Despite some reports to the contrary, the only way the public has ever experienced this song is through a surviving pre-dubbed recording of Angela Lansbury singing and a few instrumental parts that remained during the broomstick scene. And trust me, That is for the best. More unimaginative and unrelated lyrics you have never heard. It's an endless march with a boring, simplistic chorus that was absolutely best left on the cutting room floor. And I love it all the same. And that's it. 10 songs cut from musicals that you might not have known about. So next time you go see a show, think about the endless drafts, rewrites, and cut songs that went into the making of a completed musical. And do you have a favorite cut song that I missed? Leave it down in the comments or over on the Reddit. Maybe I'll talk about it next time. For now, I gotta cut out of here. Get it? Cut out? I'll be here all week. I'll be here forever. Probably.